Man tum se pyar karta hoon. Raj says that's Hindi for howdy, my sheroes and heroes. It's great to see you again. I'm very excited to be sharing some tips on personal mastery. This is one of my favorite topics. I want to talk about three relatively low-hanging fruits for helping your coworkers gain personal mastery. First, encourage the practice of mindfulness in your workplace. Mindfulness is, of course, a huge topic, and we don't have enough time to get into an elaborate discussion of mindfulness right now. But what we do know is that it not only reduces stress, thereby enabling personal mastery over feelings, it can also improve mental clarity, thereby enabling personal mastery over thoughts as well. Here's Amishi Jha of the University of Miami in two separate clips explaining her studies and her findings.
So in my lab, I'm particularly interested in understanding how attention can be protected with mindfulness training in people that are highly susceptible to vulnerabilities in their attention. So we know things like stress, poor mood, and threat can degrade our attentional abilities. And so a lot of our work works with populations for whom that's part of their professional path. So we're talking about military service members, first responders, business leaders, and all kinds of individuals for whom, you know, vulnerabilities to their attention or excessive demand on their attention aren't just annoyances that happen infrequently, but they're just part of the job. And what we're finding is that actually mindfulness training is not only not making them soft, it's actually a very tough mental workout that they think makes them tougher, meaning that they have more resilience, in particular cognitive resilience, so they're better able to meet the challenges that they encounter in their day-to-day jobs. So if you, for example, have a big event coming up, you know, we deal with lawyers and law students, so if there's a trial coming up, or for undergrads there's exam season coming up, or for elite athletes there's the actual competitive season coming up, or of course soldiers with pre-deployment leading to deployment, all of these are ramp-up periods when you've got to really start preparing yourself, but they're also high stress in and of themselves. Well, what we know is if we do nothing at all under all of those different conditions, we'll see a degradation in attention, meaning that even though you're preparing, you're actually depleting yourself in the process. And that those are the conditions under which mindfulness training, when offered for as little as 12 minutes a day, can buffer against that degradation. So it absolutely is the case that when our time is short and when our demand is high, we should be particularly paying attention to taking care of our attention through something like a mindfulness practice.
So, as you just heard, mindfulness not only protects your attention, it also makes you stronger and more capable of making tough decisions. This is why the military practices mindfulness. Why even I practice mindfulness. What more proof do you need that it makes you strong? Regular practice of mindfulness has also been found to improve response flexibility. This is an important predictor of career success. So mindfulness is a very useful practice, and your coworkers are more likely to take it up if you take it up. This is because of something called social proof. People are much more likely to do something that they see others do. The second thing that you can do is be a role model of personal mastery. Leaders with high levels of personal mastery, as I've discovered, exhibit three main traits: humility, courage, and discipline. Let me talk about humility and courage first. You exhibit humility and courage by seeking feedback from your coworkers on how you can improve at work. Humility is essential for seeking feedback, and courage is essential for actually implementing what you learn from this feedback. I have found that feedback seeking with humility and courage does two things. First, it signals to others that you don't have a big ego. That's important because other people like people who don't have giant egos. Second, it helps you learn faster. This is because most of us are blind to our own biases and negative traits. So when you ask others for feedback, you're really going around this blind spot. That helps you learn faster. Discipline is also important because nothing worthwhile is achieved without it. That's what Edison meant when he said, Genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. This is a topic Dr. Raj will cover in some depth next week. So let me move to the third thing you can do for your coworkers to help them gain personal mastery. That is to give your coworkers regular opportunities to get 360-degree feedback. 360-degree feedback, as the name suggests, is getting feedback from everyone. Peers, direct reports, managers, feedback on what? Both your strengths and your challenges. Here's how 360-degree feedback works. Typically, each person gets feedback from 6 to 12 people that they themselves choose. It is critical employees get feedback from those that they choose because that's when they will accept the feedback. It's also important that coworkers from all levels, managers, peers, and direct reports, are chosen as feedback givers. The feedback giver needs to be anonymous. This allows the feedback giver to express their honest and true opinions without bias. Finally, make sure that the feedback is constructive. If you adhere to these three rules, you should be able to deliver something extremely valuable to those employees who seek 360-degree feedback. If you want help in conducting a workshop or information session at your organization on this topic, you can look up the resources section at the end of this module. That's it for me from now. See you all later. Life is good.